an engine of what you've achieved here. The next component is to talk about the recommendations. And obviously policy is very important because you want to be able to do certain things, but the policy must be in place. But I'm going to ask Adam to run through those recommendations before I will conclude after that.
Well, we've kind of gone through a lot of the physical things, the parks, the recreation facilities, the aquatics, and so forth. But a lot of what will help the city to meet its goals and realize the vision that was set forth at the beginning has to do with policy actions, has to do with the non-physical parts of things. One of the things that we were tasked to do in this project was to look at your current park dedication ordinance. What you have on the left is basically a table of what you currently have in your ordinance today. When a new subdivision, for example, is going to be developed, what is required of that developer? Currently, your conveyance of land, you require, the way it's written in your language is 3 acres per 100 dwelling units. We express that in a term of 1 acre per dwelling unit. So 1 acre for 33 and a third dwelling units. If the decision is made to give a payment in lieu of giving land, the requirement is $750 per dwelling unit. There's not currently a park development fee, and what a park development fee is when a new subdivision comes in, there's say 100 more dwelling units, they would be required to pay a certain amount of money to actually go into the construction of the park, not just the provision of land. We also look at floodplain dedication, and if the developer chooses to dedicate floodplain versus dedicating non-floodplain land, what the ratio is. Currently, there's not a differentiation between floodplain land or non-floodplain land. And I'll get into the importance of that in a second. You do, however, have a maximum floodplain dedication that no more than 50% of the dedication can be in floodplain, and that at least 5 acres must be out of the floodplain. So if somebody is going to dedicate 10 acres, at least 5 acres have to be out. If they're going to dedicate 7 acres, at least 5 acres have to be out. That way you maintain that. And that's a good provision to have currently, because 5 acres is really what the size you want for a neighborhood park, at least 5 acres. And then you look at a minimum dedication of 1 acre of land for the development. And so if it's a smaller development, they may dedicate as little as 1 acre. If the development is so small that it would be less than an acre, you then generally would take the fee in lieu of land. What we did was we went through a pretty in-depth analysis to look at what the market rate or the value of land is and the true impact of additional development onto your resources as a city. And this says proposed revision. This is basically not necessarily proposed, but it's what you would need to do in order to account for the true cost of providing additional park land. We went through the exercise of calculating an average dollar amount per acre of land in the city. We looked at an average cost of developing a neighborhood park. We did a comparison with how many neighborhood parks, how many community parks you have currently compared to your population, and what an increase of population would then require in terms of an increase in neighborhood park acres in order to stay at your current level of service. And the result with that is that if you're a little bit low on your conveyance of land, you have 1 acre for 33 to 30 dwelling units, really 1 acre for 24 and a half dwelling units would keep it balanced, so that if 100 more dwelling units came in, they gave you roughly 4 acres, that would keep your level of service constant. Whereas what you have right now, it would actually decrease the level of service a little bit if they only gave exactly that amount. The payment in lieu of land, this is a huge jump, I know, but the payment in lieu of land at $750 per dwelling unit is not necessarily representative of the cost of land if you were going to go out and buy the parkland. And I realize that figure is really high, and in comparison with a lot of municipalities, the number you have is not incredibly low. A lot of municipalities are anywhere between $500 and maybe $1,500 per dwelling unit. But when you really look at what is that true cost, what would it actually cost you to go and use your existing taxpayer money to accommodate that additional growth, you can see that there's a really big difference in what that impact really is. We also looked at the park development fee. Again, just providing land does not address that impact that additional residents have. They also use the facilities, and there's also the need to provide and develop that park. We did a calculation of the cost to develop a neighborhood park compared to the number of people that come into a neighborhood by dwelling units, et cetera, to come up with a total of $1,400 per dwelling unit roughly as what that cost per dwelling unit would be to provide the neighborhood park to accommodate that additional growth. We have a recommendation to change your floodplain dedication ratio from 1:1 to 1:2. In that regard, it would mean that if they were required to dedicate you 5 acres of land and they wanted to give you half of that, or they wanted to give you a portion of that as floodplain, rather than just giving you 2 acres of floodplain, they'd have to give you 4 acres of floodplain, because the floodplain land is not as useful. It's not, you can't really do as much with it in terms of providing recreational facilities. And so the value of it is not the same as what a non-floodplain acre of land is. If you're going to go out and buy an acre of land and you went and bought it right next to a big river, right next to the Trinity, your cost would be much lower because you can't do anything with it. So again, it's about balancing that impact with the what is then dedicated into the park system. And then we also, we maintained what you have currently in terms of your maximum floodplain dedication. We think that that's a good ratio that you have established currently. But we would recommend, and just from a maintenance point of view, that you have a minimum dedication of 3 acres. Unless you're able to somehow, and we've had written here, unless you're able to somehow get the 1 acre from this small development and the 1 acre from that small development and the one from that small development and get them all right next to each other so you can make one park out of that. Because a bunch of 1 acre parks across the city is going to be a very big maintenance nightmare as you're trying to drive lawnmowers and do, you know, maintain all of these tiny, tiny, tiny little parks across the city. So having a minimum dedication of 3 acres may help to eliminate that. And then in those smaller developments, they would then just pay the fee in lieu of land, and you could put that into the system in a park that's nearby that development. In looking at this analysis and in looking at where you are today versus your build-out estimate, there's going to be about 15,000 new citizens that come into Louisville. The cost to develop those parks, assuming the cost of the land that it would take, the cost of actually going in and building it, is $51.9 million to match that. What you have currently in your existing ordinance would make you $4.5 million. So you can already see the big discrepancy there. Where does that money come from? You know, that's going to have to come from bonds. It's going to have to come from additional sources. However, if you were to do something more along these lines, these proposed revisions would get you much closer to that cost. Does that make sense? I know that's a lot of kind of number crunching to get in there, but basically the gist of it is what you have today, and this is the case for a lot of cities, this is something that a lot of cities are looking at because they're realizing that what you have in your ordinance today does not necessarily cover the true cost of what that impact is going to be. I'm just going to pause real quick because I know somebody's going to...
Yeah, however, the existing base of people get to use that proposed extra, and that proposed extra is not just to meet the goal, it's also to catch up to where those averages are, correct?
No.
This
was established based upon some work that was recently done by a man named John Crompton. He's with Texas A&M, and he's dedicated his life to basically parkland dedication ordinances. That's what his field study has been, or at least that's what I know him best for. And he's really looking at the constitutionality of the park dedication ordinances and how well they'll pass muster, how well they really are reflective of impacts and so forth. And the whole, not to get too much into the legal thing, but the whole issue of takings and the relevance between that and between the impact. And we followed a methodology that he had established that looks primarily or look solely at what you have today versus what the people you have today, that population versus that acreage, and continuing that on for future and not trying to get the new development to catch you up to where you want to be. So what we talked about earlier with increasing your level of service, that does not come from this. You're not trying to get, this is not trying to get the new people to help catch you up.
So to summarize, to keep our level of service exactly the same as we have it today, for that 111,000 number, it's going to cost $51.9 million by his methodology.
Only for community and neighborhood parks. Yeah. Yes is the short answer, but there are also things like open space, special purpose parks, etc., that you can't closely tie that in with an impact by any residents. So if all you did was build this for the new residents, you would, your level of service would still decrease a little bit, unless you also had some green belts and had some special purpose parks and some of those things that don't. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Does that make sense to everybody else? Okay. It is a very, I mean, it's a pretty powerful thing to look at, to see that impact. But that's something that we have in here, we have more information about. And it's just a recommendation to take a look at. I mean, this would be a tough sell, I know, to try to get balance books.
How did you derive at your payment in lieu of land that's 10 times what we're doing?
The payment in lieu of land fee, I'm looking for the exact number. Yeah, basically, what we did was we looked at whatever available property listings we could find, and what properties listed for versus what property sells for can be very different, I know. But we looked at what was available at the time, and we looked primarily at unimproved land, and primarily, I believe, we looked at only things larger than an acre. We didn't want to look at quarter acre or fifth of an acre, because the cost for those tend to be larger. But we looked at those costs and came up with a number of $175,000 an acre as being a cost of land. And if there's anybody in the room that has a figure that is more accurate than that, we can definitely revisit it.
How much for an acre?
$175,000.
This 15,000 meters.
Yes.
What year was that?
2013. Yes. 2013.
30. 30. 30. Yes. I'm sure. Okay.
Okay.
Do you know, are other cities implementing that park development fee?
A lot of cities do have a park development fee in place.
We have one, but it's not on, it's just on single family, right?
No, we have a
paper building. Well, paper building.
Yeah. What, are you speaking about the $7,000 figure?
Yeah.
That is something that people are looking at. I don't know of any cities locally that have gone up to that level. I think if any have, then maybe College Station has taken that approach, because that's...
It's common in other states more so than in Texas.
You said this area is typically more like 550 per dwelling. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And that's where the challenge really comes in,
Who's at the top of the curve?
Who moves first? I believe it's... I know Colleyville is very high, and I think Highland Park. What we wanted to do here is really present you with the facts of, you know, based on our best guess, this is the cost, and this is what it would be per dwelling unit.
But I understand what you're doing.
Yeah.
It's just the reality.
It's a hard sell. Absolutely, it would be a hard sell to get that in place.
And I would like to add what John Crompton also is very specific about, is he want to make sure that what you recommend or what you choose and adopt is defendable. If the developers sue you on this, you'll be able to defend that based on what Adam said. It's based on what you currently provide for a certain number of population to keep that same standard. That's what the courts are looking at. You want to keep the same standard. Yes, you have that amount that need to be paid by the developer, but you need to do that to keep the standard. You know, at the end of the day, what happens is that the developer anyway add that cost to the end product. And most probably that means it's going to have a better quality product be provided to the new citizens.
You would slam the door shut on low-end apartments if you did that.
That'll be the upside.
Well, this is not a comparison with any other city.
The other presentation you have with all the different parks and stuff, different tax rates, different demographic, different people, willing to pay certain things to go to their local thing. You might as well compare it to University Park
hasn't got a station, but yes.
If he wants to be Keller or Colleyville, then we're going to need the same tax rate, same type of people. It's not really
Do you know what their tax rates are?
That's a policy question.
Are they color tax rates higher than Lewis?
Well, we're the...
Right.
That's a policy question for the council to discuss. It's, you know, the consultants are really looking at it fairly objectively and making some assumptions about what you want. And ultimately, when you finalize this plan, you have to make some decisions about what you really do want. So that's kind of the purpose for this exercise.
I agree.
Absolutely.
I guess it's kind of, in an ideal world, if there weren't any other issues, then this is the way to capture it.
It's like a gas tax.
Yeah.
If you really wanted to fully load what my cost of a vehicle is on a road, my gas tax would be a lot higher than it is today.
Right. It actually be used when it's meant to.
Perfect analogy. Some of the other things that are included in here in terms of policy, a floodplain protection plan. And with this, we're starting to kind of expand a little bit beyond your typical parks and recreation, because the interconnectivity between open space preservation, which is a big task of this plan, and trail provision, which is the primary focus of the trail master plan, which is kind of the companion to this, is really the preservation of corridors and preservation of those creek corridors, which are your primary opportunities for trails. So one of the things that we've looked at, and we've talked with your engineering, we talked with really all the departments about this approach, is to start looking at your floodplain ordinance and your floodplains from a fully developed point of view. When your city's developed out completely, where would that floodplain level be? Because today, in a creek, your floodplain may be this wide because there's a lot of, you know, there's not a lot of concrete around it. But as you build out, the floodplain's going to get wider and wider with the more concrete that's there and more water's going to drain in. So identifying where those limits may be in the future is a great way to help preserve that open space and keep it from being encroached, and long-term will help to save money from having to go back and rehabilitate and analyze and do a lot of those things. The city, if anybody's interested, the city of Allen is a good example of what, of how advanced planning of the floodplains can result in great greenways and a very minimal amount of engineering having to go on in order to address flooding issues. So that's kind of all the things that are tied in with that approach. There are a few other things that are a little bit more minor in there, but potentially looking at an inventory of where some of your cultural and environmental resources exist as a way to help you identify where may be good places to pull your resources to try to protect, try to preserve, and try to acquire open space or appropriate somehow from other sources in the core, for example. And one of the things that I think is really important to getting in here is embracing Lewisville Lake. I mean, you already have done a lot, and there's a lot of opportunity there, but I think it's such a key thing that it has to be part of any parks, recreation, open space plan to really put that up as an important thing, that the lake be seen as a primary, not the primary recreational resource for the region, really. And there's some recommendations in there about trail connections and what's in the trail plan, as well as things that may not be, smaller things, pathways to make sure that people can access places. And then additional lakeside amenities. And the potential of having additional festivals and events there at Lake Park to get people out there to really help reinforce that as part of your image and part of your brand. I'm going to turn it back over to Francois now to talk a little bit more about dollars and cents.
Well, thank you, Adam. And the culmination of the recommendations truly is the action plan, because that tells you what are the different actions to be able to achieve that vision that you have for the city. And you may look at this and see it as being a high dollar amount. Well, that's the laundry list. That's the type of things that you would like to do to achieve that vision that you have in mind. So to summarize, for outdoor priorities, what we have there is that you modernize your existing parks, that you have those new playgrounds, pavilions, new trails, as Adam mentioned earlier, etc. Also that you follow through with your trails master plan and make sure you get the network of trails throughout your city. After all, that is so important to the community. Create access points along Elm Fork of the Trinity River as part of this paddle trail that you have there, but make that more visible, make it accessible to people, even just to go and walk along there, or even just to be able to view and see the beauty of that tremendous resource that you have in this city. Some new neighborhood parks that need to be constructed in underserved areas is the fourth priority. And then the full service tennis court, the 12 court with that, the pro shop, the restrooms, etc. that will go with that. Indoor priorities, the first one there is to upgrade and renovate the Frederick Herring Recreation Center, to develop a new recreation indoor aquatic center, and Wayne gave some good examples of what one can look up, can look at. And I so agree that the council need to see what is happening around in the region to get some good inspiration and some direction as to what they want to achieve for the city. The senior center, as again the baby boomer group grows and their needs also grow, but also the diversity of their needs grow. That's a third priority to make sure that we address that. Hedrick House being renovated as the fourth priority, and then the Gamble Savage Senior Committee Room as the fifth priority. So in terms of cost, in terms of actions, policy actions, we didn't allocate any time, any dollar value to that. That's a city activity through staff and through council, but you don't need to really allocate other than staff time to that. Land acquisition for that 350 acres, as we mentioned earlier, there's a price tag of $31.5 million. For park development and improvement, it's 18.1. But note that that also includes the 8.6 that are estimated for the trails plan. So it's not only parks separate from trails, but it includes the travel component. And then the recreational maintenance facilities, 6.1 million. And then some studies and plans, because you have to study further. You have to study exactly what you want. You have to have your feasibility studies. And we've identified that in the action plan, as well as different studies are. That is less than half a million, or eight, and less than a quarter million. So I want to conclude with this, that you've seen today everything in terms of your recreation, parks, and open space aspect of your city. We've demonstrated to you that you do have a great opportunity to increase the quality and the value, and especially where you are located. You're located next to the lake, the lake that has your name. You are on 35. I almost see you as the north gateway to the Metroplex, as Arlington perhaps is the southern gateway. I think you are key. And as the economic conditions are going to change, and as the growth in this area will happen in the future, Vision North Texas talks about tremendous growth in the next 10, 20 years. We need more facilities, and to keep up with the facilities and the opportunities. But we also want to make you a prime place to want to be. So the quality that you want to achieve is crucial. And we want to urge you that you make that as part of your vision, that you want to stand out within the Metroplex as a place for people to talk about and to go and settle and to live. So with that, thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Okay, have any questions, any other questions or comments? Okay. Okay. Thank you, gentlemen, very much. I appreciate it. 11:45, and we'll get time to...
We can start.